Hello and welcome to Politics Today. I'm Farooq Pratafi. We are, of course, this program is a continuation of our commentary on Prime Minister's successful visit to the U.S. Especially two very important developments or points of focus have emerged. One is Afghanistan, because in the past few days, you must have listened to the discussion, and a lot has transpired regarding Afghanistan's peace process. Zalmay Khalilzad yesterday arrived in Kabul as well. One aspect is that we are going to discuss in the program, and if we get time, we are going to talk about the second nodal point, that is Kashmir issue, because the Indian atrocities in Kashmir continue. And despite that, when Donald Trump has offered his good offices for the negotiation between the two countries, it seems that India has thrown another hissy fit. Their media has gone bonkers. Unfortunately, we have to mention them, otherwise that media doesn't even qualify to be called media anymore. But regardless, their parliament also was struggling yesterday and today, and we have to take stock of those developments as well. In order to help us understand these issues, we are joined by an eminent panel. We are joined by Umar Farooq Saab, a senior journalist. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Air Vice Marshal, retired Faiz Ameer Saab. He's not only a defense analyst, but also VC of a university. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Kamran Yusuf. If you read English newspapers in this country, he needs no introduction. He is one of the finest diplomatic correspondents as well, and a columnist as well. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. But first of all, Umar Farooq Saab, let us talk about Pakistan's potential role in Afghan peace process. How do you see Pakistan can contribute to the process?
You see, in Washington, two levels of meeting took place. One between the our military officials, chief of the army staff, and their military officials, and their the chief of the army staff also met the secretary of state.
Yeah. And a third tier also, our intelligence met their intelligence.
Yeah, their intelligence. So, and Prime Minister himself discussed this peace process, Afghan peace process, with the President Trump as well. So I would say now Pakistani leadership, political and military leadership, must have a fairly good understanding of different positions that American, different American departments, Department of Defense, and State Department has about Afghan peace process.
Right. So let me first break it down. Let me ask you, are we on the same page? Are when you, we are talking about Pakistan, do you think leadership, civil and military leadership of Pakistan is on the same page?
You see, the influence that the international media talks about, the Pakistani influence on Taliban, it basically is based on Pakistani Pakistani military's capacity to influence the Taliban and the Afghan tribes located in the south of Afghanistan. So, but you see, Prime Minister Imran Khan has to play a very important role in this process, but because he let me
No, but my question is very simple. Army chief and the Prime Minister and the intelligence chief go together to Washington. Do you think that they are on the same page? Yes.
No, I'm coming to that point. You see, I think they are on the same page.
Okay. So when you say that when we are trying to actually study, or finally we must have good idea of how various departments of the US actually see the situation, are you telling me that they are not on the same page?
You see, the thing we have been hearing from Washington, the reports that are coming to Islamabad from Washington, tell us about very different perspective that the State Department and the Defense Department has about talks with Taliban.
That's a very good answer. Let me bring in AVM Saab, your take, sir. How can we contribute, and whether the U.S. in itself has a consensus on how to tackle Afghanistan?
As far as U.S. is concerned, this visit was about one point, and there was extrication, safe extrication from Afghanistan. So the entire visit focused on, at all levels, on Afghanistan.
Only Afghanistan, not Iran, not India.
I would say major portion probably was given to Afghanistan because of obvious reasons of impending elections and both in Afghanistan and in US. Yeah. But I think there would be different levels of talks, I would agree. First is the agreement itself, the guarantees to the agreement. Second is the how many forces of the US are going to stay back, or is the withdrawal total? What is the American perspective on it? And I think the most important part is the post-withdrawal Afghanistan. So these are three different phases of Afghan issue that probably would have been discussed or should have been discussed in that sequence.
Right.
Because each one of them in itself is very important.
Right.
It's not only the agreement that the Americans reach with Taliban or Pakistan brokers that peace process, but it is also important is that what kind of forces are going to remain there, what Afghanistan the US is going to leave behind for its neighbors.
Okay.
And most so, have they asked for any role from Pakistan in post-withdrawal Afghanistan? That's
sure.
very important.
Right.
Because the entire edifice of this peace process mm-hmm. lies on guarantees mm-hmm. that who's going to do what. A successful visit it raises hopes and it raises expectations.
Right.
That is what this particular visit has done.
And this commitment or somehow this implication that Pakistan is going to convince Afghan Taliban to talk to the Kabul government as well, because that has been a sticking point. Do you think it can work?
I think it has a lot of pitfalls in it.
Mm-hmm.
The basic pitfall when the Prime Minister says that he is going to meet the Taliban and convince them to talk to the U.S., I think is committing beyond
one's own region,
I think. Okay. That is where the caution must lie.
Okay.
But
it's a good answer, right? Good commitment.
Well, yes.
It shows your intention. I mean,
yes.
You doesn't show whether you have the kind of control over or sway over Taliban or not.
Western media especially, exaggerate Pakistan's capacity to influence Taliban.
Yeah,
you see,
we might have contributed to that in the previous decade.
When you say that, you say that with a certain level of confidence, that when I'm going to meet them, so I have the relationship with them to meet them,
mm-hmm.
and then convince them to come to the Afghan talks with the Afghan government. Now, that can be quoted against you 6 months down.
It can be, but with due respect, throughout our history, we have no dearth of statements that can be used against us.
Yes, and that is.
And there are interesting aspects that I'm going to actually not discuss later in the program as well, but let me bring in Kamran Yousafzai. Your take on Afghanistan peace process and how Pakistan can contribute. Can we contribute at all?
The fact that Prime Minister Imran Khan visited the White House suggested that Pakistan has already played a role that has, because many people see that this is a kind of an acknowledgement from the top U.S. leadership, and now they want from Pakistan to take this fragile peace process to the next level.
Okay.
There are two clear demands, mm-hmm. absolutely clear demands, and I'm sure that must have been discussed during this visit.
Yeah.
One that the Americans now clearly want that Pakistan should persuade Afghan Taliban for a permanent ceasefire.
Okay.
Second, as you already mentioned, that they want from Pakistan to convince mm-hmm. Taliban to engage with the Kabul administration.
Okay.
So these are the two clear demands from the U.S. Now the question is, as you said, that there are certain meetings that we have seen in the White House, but there were certain engagements that
elsewhere.
Took place in Pentagon and probably in Langley, and where I believe that more substantive part of this visit must have taken place.
Okay.
So what kind of commitments that Pakistan has given?
I didn't say anything
given?
About Langley though.
Okay,
I mean,
just,
it is your take, right?
Okay. What kind of commitment that Pakistan has given to the U.S. leadership and the US government, that is very important. Mm-hmm. Because we know that at the moment, we are really happy that in terms of optics and the PR is concerned, mm-hmm. Pakistan Prime Minister has done really well. Now, okay. The substantive part is, for example, no, my fear is...
Substantive part is that after 3 years of Donald Trump becoming president, finally, a Pakistani Prime Minister managed to meet him. Is it not a big thing?
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying. That's optics. That's what I'm saying. As far as optics are concerned, and as I said, for Americans' perspective, when they invite leader from countries like Pakistan to the White House, okay. From their perspective, there is a big concession. That's why you already talked about that there is a difference within the U.S. administration. State Department was not in favor of inviting Prime Minister Imran Khan at this stage because okay. They thought, let Pakistan do more, let have some tangible outcome on Afghan process.
But then
the White House said that, look, no, okay,
this is a very interesting dynamic that you are pointing to. In the past, the Pentagon is supposed to be hawkish, right? They are the war machine. And the State Department is supposed to be the peace machine, right? Peace Department. You're telling me that Pentagon is not doves, and it is State Department which is hawks? And
yes.
How so?
Yeah, because if you see even the talks that took place at the White House, there was, though that Prime Minister did meet Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, but he was not there in the delegation that at the White House.
Right.
So there was clear indication that State Department they were not against the visit. They wanted little more from the Pakistani side. They thought that the Afghan peace process still very fragile. So it probably premature inviting Prime Minister Imran Khan at this stage and giving him this big concession.
Are you reading it from the absence of Mike Pompeo?
No, not necessarily. I'm talking about
your own sources.
On sources and information that I am getting.
Okay, that's good. I just wanted to highlight that.
Yes, because this visit took place primarily because Pakistani diplomacy had worked. Mm-hmm. They bypassed the American bureaucracy. They approached White House directly and somehow, because that's how under Trump administration or under Trump's presidency, that's how currently U.S. administration is operating. Mm-hmm. So State Department was, to my information, was not on board as far as this
was
concerned.
No, but with due respect, we didn't see Mike Pompeo during the sittings. But we saw, especially when it came to the delegation level meeting, we saw clear representation of State Department.
No, certainly there was there, but we are talking about that there were certainly differences.
Right, sir.
You see, Pakistan will get itself into trouble if it accepts the demand of U.S. administration to make sure that no violence takes place in Afghanistan while these talks are going on. Mm-hmm. You see, if Taliban are talking to the Americans, Taliban will soon be talking to the Afghan government. But if
will
the American demands, maybe, yeah. Possibility is there. Yeah. But if American demands Pakistan that you ensure that no violence takes place in Afghanistan,
okay. That
will be a very tricky thing. I don't think Pakistan should go into that.
No, but Pakistan has not committed to that. Of course, Pakistan is going to be a channel. Taliban is not a monolith.
Mm-hmm. It's not a monolith.
Okay.
And ensuring Pakistani exercising its influence on Taliban and making sure that no violence takes place in Afghanistan, that is not a possibility.
No, but when you say that it is not a monolith, are you saying that there is no central organization at all?
It's a militia. It's not a military, organized military force.
No, but during Mullah Umar's time, they used to have an organogram and they used to have a command structure. Now they don't have any?
No, but I think still it's a militia. It's a ragtag militia. They have diplomats going around different capitals. But still, at the military level, it's a ragtag militia.
Okay.
You see?
Okay.
Not properly trained military force.
So, if Pakistan cannot actually convince them to A, go for a ceasefire, B, to talk to the Kabul government, what is that we are committing?
Bring
and how
them
do we,
to the table.
How do we
they,
see ourselves useful?
They have
useful?
Brought them to the table with the Americans. That's
okay.
enough. That's not.
That is the past.
But I think America believes that's not enough.
Okay.
Because it sounds good when we say that, okay, fine, we should tell them, okay, we don't have any influence.
No,
the
but
main issue.
But you just mentioned that they are not on the same page.
I have been talking to many
Which
American
America
diplomats.
Which America are you talking about then?
They are convinced that Pakistan still exercises a lot of influence over Afghan Taliban. It's okay. Not necessarily the international media that is talking about. Mm-hmm. Now, the main issue is if the Americans really still believe that we have the influence, we have the key to Afghan Taliban,
okay,
then that's where the major challenge lies.
Right.
You know, if the Americans, if we can't convince the Americans, then you know you have a serious problem.
But when you said that America doesn't agree with this perception, earlier you were telling us that State Department has its own views and White House has different.
No, in terms of I was talking about in terms of inviting Prime Minister Imran Khan.
Yeah.
That whether they should
have
invited at
this
juncture.
No, but there was this perception. Hang on.
But when it comes to
Kamran Sahib, you just said that the State Department had this impression that perhaps whatever Pakistan has done is not enough.
Yes.
And it needs to do more.
Yes.
But White House was convinced that it has done a lot and there is the time for encouragement, right?
Yeah, that's it, yes.
So they are not agreeing in principle.
But White House and the State Department and the Pentagon, they all believe in one thing, that Pakistan still has the influence over the Taliban.
Right.
That's the question.
Let me ask AVM Saab, sir, how much influence does Pakistan have on Taliban?
I think when State Department or Khalilzadeh says that we are close to an agreement, it means both parties have committed themselves to an agreement.
Right.
And when they lay down a deadline by beginning of September, we will have an agreement. I think things are moving much faster behind the scene than probably we're discussing here.
Mm-hmm.
There are four critical things that are there, that they're included, and we all know about them. Mm-hmm. The first one is the troops withdrawal.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is the guarantee by the Taliban that the land will not be used.
Against
the third
other
is the ceasefire. And the fourth is the discussion between the Afghans and the Talibans.
Okay.
I think you cannot have an agreement and you cannot hope to have an agreement, and the Americans cannot claim that they have an agreement unless the movement has taken place in all these four particular subjects.
Mm-hmm.
So I think at this moment to say that how much influence does Pakistan have, I think Pakistan has already delivered that kind of a momentum. The momentum has to be maintained by now the parties involved.
Mm-hmm.
And the parties involved are definitely three parties, Afghanistan, Taliban, and America.
Yeah, and now there are basically two parties, US and Taliban.
No, I think when the Taliban received a mixed Afghan delegation, which included the Taliban, Afghanistan government people as their in their personal capacity, I think that process has already started.
And how do you address the concern that Umar Saab has actually voiced, that Taliban might not be a monolith, that they are a ragtag band of militiamen, and they might not actually follow the agreement?
Wasn't that fact known to all parties?
Yeah.
That fact is known to all parties that Afghanistan, Taliban have never been a monolith. And yeah. Taliban also are reluctant to agree to a ceasefire, because if they agree to ceasefire, their so-called unity, the commanders that they hold, they're going to fall apart and they're going to look for their new jobs.
Okay.
So I think that fear remains there.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why I'm saying the fear is that Pakistan may not commit as a guarantor on behalf of Taliban.
Okay.
That is the most dangerous thing, that probably we have delivered the Taliban to the table, the talks have resumed, there are hopes of an agreement, but is there a role being asked from Pakistan to play after the agreement?
Okay.
That is a danger point.
Okay, now let me move a bit forward. I know there are many moving parts in it, but let us assume that role is played. And everything goes according to plan, and there is some kind of intra-Afghan dialogue, and then there's the coalition government and withdrawal of the US forces. How do you see Afghanistan beyond withdrawal? Do you think it is going to stay stabilized?
Before that, I want to just something flashed in my mind. Ronald Reagan receiving Taliban at the White House.
Yeah.
it was a recognition of their strength. And it was also not to it was also to convey
so not Taliban, Afghan Mujahideen. And they were compared with the founding fathers of the US.
So you had the Afghan Mujahideen being received at the White House, and it was in recognition of their power, the position they held, and it was also to convey the American expectations to the Afghan Mujahideen. Today, Pakistan is being received at White House in recognition of its role that it can play, and is being communicated. The irony is
why would you compare Pakistan with Afghan Mujahideen?
It just occurred to me, the irony is that Americans needed Pakistan when they wanted to enter Afghanistan, and they again need Pakistan when they want to leave Afghanistan. And that is the significance of Pakistan in this region, that Afghan probably the Americans cannot lose sight of. Now, when you ask me about the stability in Afghanistan post withdrawal, as much as the Taliban are not a monolith, the other side is also fragmented.
Yeah, other side is actually warlords.
So you cannot see a very stable. One would like to see a very stable Afghanistan, but probably they will have to. I hope that is without a bloodbath.
Okay.
That they reach a consensus. They understand that 40 years of bloodbath is enough. And they need to sit down. But remember, there's 40 years
or 200 years?
No, I'm counting from 1979 onwards.
The entire history is full of
bloodshed. Yeah, I'm counting from 1979 onwards.
It's a tribal society.
But another very important card, a very important element, are the drug lords, not the warlords so much, the drug lords. Yeah. And the drug economy is going to play more unsettling influence on the future of Afghanistan than the warlords or than either of them.
Okay, especially the opiates,
opiates.
That
also is in the southern part of the country.
Yeah, but here's another aspect. While we keep on focusing on peace process in Afghanistan, which is essentially political, the actual crisis of Afghanistan is economic. It is not economically viable or sustainable for the current government to carry on without external help. And we hear that Kabul is surrounded by warlords who have been filching money from the US coffers, and now they are actually, in effect, billionaires. And they are just biding their time. The moment US leaves, they are just going to start doing exactly what they have been doing.
You see,
how optimistic then are you that it is going to be a stable Afghanistan?
The biggest failure of the West, especially the Americans, in Afghanistan, I think Americans are facing a military defeat in Afghanistan. They are not. What they are facing is a failure to create a functioning state in Afghanistan.
Yeah. Why should they actually be trying? And this was the point of Donald Trump's campaign, that nation building is not our job.
You see, when they started the Bonn Conference, the Bonn process, was intended to create a functioning state. Different Western countries was allocated different duties. Someone was allocated the duty to create the judiciary. Someone was with the police creation of establishment of police force. Americans were given the duty to create an army.
Yeah, so they did. But who's going to pick the tab? If the US leaves, who's going to pay the money?
No, you see, the problem is that they don't know how to create a functioning state in a country which does not have a tradition of a modern state.
Okay.
You see, it's a tribal society.
No, but they used to have a state.
It
was Soviet-influenced state, but they used to have a state structure. And that's why all the children of Parcham and Khalk people actually keep on complaining were actually part of the bureaucracy there. That it is you and America and other countries that destroyed that state. Nobody else did.
I think it's not a modern state. Modern state is never existed in Afghanistan. The modern state never existed in Afghanistan.
Okay. Right. But Kamran Yusuf, we can look at the peace process or peace building. But how do you fix the matter of economy? If there is no economy, vultures are already surrounding the place. They are going to start attacking.
Probably this is also part of the discussion, because what the Americans are telling the Afghan Taliban, look, that if you agree on a peaceful solution to this 18-year-long conflict, then obviously for rebuilding and reconstruction, we will continue to pump in the money. And that's why they probably want to retain certain bases within Afghanistan, probably for, they say, for counter-terrorism purposes.
Okay.
And in this aspect, the role
can
of China...
Can you identify those, Kandahar?
Not because I am not privy
Bagram.
To where exactly that they wanted to station their
No, Bagram bases. Has to stay because it is by far the biggest investment, right?
Okay, but the because this is important aspect, and in this area, China is also is very key.
Mm-hmm.
And recently, if you have seen that China's role in Afghanistan with regard to Afghan Taliban have really increased. Number of Afghan Taliban leaders have been visiting Beijing.
Yeah.
And China, the leverage China is using is again, they are somehow persuading or pressurizing Afghan Taliban to agree on some kind of a deal. In return, they are offering that look that if you agree on some kind of a deal, we will also support you for reconstruction and rebuilding.
Financially,
we will support you. So the incentive is there.
You're talking about some framework connected to CPEC? Or something new because they have already won the contracts
because
on
even
minerals.
The success of the CPAC is linked with what happens in Afghanistan.
Right.
Suppose if there is a peace and relative peace in Afghanistan post U.S. withdrawal.
Well, CPAC actually doesn't pass through Afghanistan.
No, but it has an impact because of the security situation today Pakistan has been facing or has been facing for many years. Primarily, it is because of Afghanistan.
Yeah.
And suppose that if there is another phase of civil war in Afghanistan, if there is another influx of Afghan refugees, so you know that what kind of security implications Pakistan may face. And by consequence, of course, that your economy and even your foreign investment may be affected. So China also has a great incentive here because they also want to see a peace and stability in Afghanistan. And that's why... I think in that sense, I think Pakistan even can use the good offices of China if suppose that Afghan Taliban are not really getting convinced on certain things. China can also come in and
leverage
and tell them that look,
Russia
that this is
also. Moscow also.
Moscow also. So there is also then the you know the regional approach as well. So,
but
in that sense,
we tried that, Kamran Saab, through the erstwhile QCG.
Yes.
The Quad process. Nothing happened. I mean, in the end, it was the U.S. and Taliban that had to talk.
But at that time, still, you know, if you talk to the Americans, they were still not willing to talk directly to Afghan Taliban because they had certain preconditions.
Okay.
But now, Americans have shown great concessions. They are talking directly to the Afghan Taliban because this is the precondition that Afghan Taliban, you know, had previously. So in, that's why the things are moving in the right direction.
Okay.
So that's why the current process is more, I should say, tangible. And also, the Afghan Taliban representatives who are negotiating with the Americans have the mandate and authority from the Taliban leadership. Previously, whoever they were talking to, they were not authorized to talk on some of the main issues.
You're saying Mullah Baradar is very strong.
Yes, Mullah Baradar. And I think the Americans were happy in that sense because one of the concerns earlier of the Americans were, even when they were talking to the Taliban, they were concerned that those Taliban figure were not that much authoritative. They could not implement the decision. And that's why Pakistan, on the request of the U.S., released Mullah Baradar. And Mullah Baradar now has the mandate. Whatever decision they reach with the Americans, he will ensure to implement.
You actually reminded me of the previous leader who was killed in while coming back from Iran,
Mullah Mansoor.
And there was a time when UK, British government, was ripped off by a certain pretender who said that he's Taliban's Mullah Mansoor, and he wasn't. But as AVM sir, let us talk about another aspect because I'm then going to connect it with Kashmir also. India and Pakistan have always had competing interests in Kabul or Afghanistan. And that also seems to wreck the entire situation. Pakistan, when they used to say that Pakistan needs strategic depth, that was that India used to say that we are going to just attack Pakistan and control, cut it into two halves. And then we would say, okay, we can retreat to Afghanistan and that will be our strategic depth. Now the concern is, instead of treating Afghanistan as some place where you have to fight for spoils, is it possible for India and Pakistan, using the good offices of Donald Trump, to actually come on same page, not only on Kashmir, but also on Afghanistan?
Well, let me first make a comment on the American withdrawal from Afghanistan.
So please.
Not only that America has lost its war in Afghanistan militarily, it has also lost a war where, despite over $1 trillion spent, there's not a sign of economy in that country. So okay. I think Americans have lost.
Will you allow me to interject here?
Yes, go ahead.
Their main purpose when they came was Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda. They managed to actually uproot that.
No,
and with due respect, the rest was the failure of their goodness of heart.
They should have
kept
left.
On throwing in money.
They should have left in 2011 then.
Yeah, but
they should
didn't.
Have left, but they
Obama.
Did. So it is not, no, it is not Obama. They should have left in 2014 when they announced. It was their changing perspective, strategic perspective of the region that they kept changing their positions okay. from. So I think not only that, when you don't win, you're losing. Mm. You may have won objectives, but you have not won the war. You may have won battles, but you have not won the war. And second thing is, the mere fact that over $1 trillion, $1.2 or $1.5 trillion dollars, matters who is counting that, there's not a sign of economy in that country.
Yeah.
So they have lost on both accounts. They have lost on both accounts miserably. Now let's come back to the possibility of Pakistan
and India.
India. I think at the moment, India is counting its losses. And they're trying to make up in Afghanistan, because at the moment when US recognizes the primacy of Pakistan's influence in that country, that is at the moment it looks like is at the cost of India. Mm-hmm. So whereas Pakistan would not like to share any important role in Afghanistan with India, yes, Pakistan would be ready to work with India on Kashmir.
Right, but building consensus and at least agreeing to some terms that you have transit trade and then we are going to support each other's concerns, is it not a good thing?
No, that is giving India...
Because then trade
Pakistan
can
has
actually
shown,
help build the economy in
Pakistan
Afghanistan.
Pakistan has shown its readiness to provide a corridor to Indian trade to Afghanistan.
Yeah.
They've recently talked about it.
Okay.
That is okay. But giving any military influence or any deep-rooted political influence, probably Pakistan would not be a party to that.
Right. Umar Farooq Saab, you agree
Indian
with that
work
perception?
In Afghanistan is basically related to business, commerce, economy.
Mm-hmm.
All the projects they are running.
Their parliament and their biggest hospital and all that.
Yeah, buildings.
Buildings also.
I don't think Indians have even tried to make any, assert themselves militarily in Afghanistan.
Yeah.
They haven't tried.
No, but
they can't succeed in that enterprise.
Umar Farooq Saab, we are not talking about military presence per se, because Afghanistan in the end has to have an army, and that army is supposed to actually sustain itself, right? At this moment, we are talking about Afghanistan's economy, which can be bolstered if you start connecting Central Asia with South Asia, the CASA format.
Of course.
That will happen when South Asia actually can see eye to eye.
Yeah, of course. Of course, I agree with you. You see, this is a very novel idea that I want to have breakfast in Kabul, lunch in Islamabad, and dinner in New Delhi.
Okay.
You see, this will connect.
That will never happen. I can assure you that has already happened.
That has already happened. When Prime Minister...
It might happen when you are Zalmay Khalilzad. It won't happen for you and me.
You see, this will increase the connectivity of the region. This will increase business, commerce, industry.
Yeah.
This will give boost to economy.
Then you'll have to actually work on the underlying...
The Americans have
reasons for competition between India and Pakistan, right? Then you'll have to work on resolving Kashmir. Without doing that, India and Pakistan can never see each other as partners. Is it true?
Can you repeat that question?
No, in order to fulfill that dream that you were talking about, first you'll have to work on resolving the underlying disputes.
Yeah, of course, that's a given. That's a given. The Kashmir issue has to be resolved politically, and other issues has to be resolved between Pakistan and India.
Okay.
To Afghanistan game the rule. Americans have been telling Pakistanis to arrive at some kind of a consensus with Indians, to arrive at a rules of the game, to establish a rules of game with the Indians.
Right. But that doesn't seem to be happening.
Yeah.
Because you have one of the most difficult governments in New Delhi. You can talk about Kamran if you want to contribute to the idea of India and Pakistan working together and resolving the issues regarding, not Kashmir right now, but Afghanistan. First address that, then we are going to move to
Kashmir. I think that is the most important aspect, because I know that the moment Pakistan have legitimate concerns and also believe that India doesn't have any role when it comes to, you know, the peace in Afghanistan. But if we see the larger picture, you also indicated that both Pakistan and India have competing interests in Afghanistan. Yeah. We both have concerns. Pakistan has concerns that India may use Afghan soil against us.
We say that
they are using. Of course, that we cited the example of many, you know, consulates and all that. And even India also feel that ungoverned places within Afghanistan provide a perfect ground for jihadi organization that can also, you know, be a serious problem for India and even in the Indian occupied Kashmir. Mm. So there are concerns from both sides. And if there is, you know, any Afghan deal, at the end of the day, I believe that Americans will have to nudge both Pakistan and India to sit across the table, not necessarily publicly, but maybe from behind the scene, because unless and until both countries develop some kind of, you know, understanding on Afghanistan, because there is always a possibility, if India feels that whatever peace deal the Americans, with the help of Pakistan, is reaching in Afghanistan, that may be counterproductive for their interests. Mm-hmm. So there is a possibility that they try to play a role of a spoiler.
Okay.
So you need to talk to the Indians. And for it is...
If you remember, that was what exactly happened when Shah Mahmood Qureshi went to Moscow before the start of the process, Moscow, China, elsewhere. At that time, he left, or we are told, he left a message with Moscow that you have to convince India as well and inform these are the plans and take them on board. So Pakistan was trying to be inclusive when it came to peace building or peace process. Can it happen that India and Pakistan start to agree on Afghanistan's future?
I think it is a possibility, and it has to happen. Because
with Narendra Modi in
you know
New Delhi.
And even as we speak, I believe that for some time there has been back channel diplomacy going on between Pakistan and India.
Okay.
I have the information. It's not, there won't be any dramatic shift as we have seen in the past, but both sides have been quietly working.
Yeah,
and probably this, you know, I
sort of saw the problem that lies there, right? Yesterday, when Donald Trump's statement came, all of a sudden, your Hindutva government became docile and Congress became the actual standard bearer of Hindutva. And they were lashing out at Modi.
But I think you have to be realistic. In politics, this happens. Even if, suppose if in Pakistan, if happens, you know, you always...
Rahul Gandhi has proven to be a Hamlet,
Even in Pakistan, when even Bilawal Bhutto Zardari and Asif Ali Zardari used to call Nawaz Sharif Modi ka yaar, though they also have a policy of reaching out to India. So you don't, I don't take it very seriously when Congress criticizes Modi.
You see Pakistan and India talking in Afghanistan, only if Pakistan sees a role for India in Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm.
When you look eastwards for your major problems that you've been facing for the past 70 years, then Afghanistan is your backyard. Mm-hmm. And you don't want an adversary in your backyard, on the other front. So you don't want an adversary over there. That's very clear. Till the time you have issues, I think Pakistan and India will talk about Afghanistan when the Afghanistan has stabilized.
Why do you consider Afghanistan to be a backyard?
No, backyard, what I mean is that it's on your backside. So you have a two-front war situation.
Okay.
In that sense,
are you talking about sphere of influence?
No, I'm not talking of sphere. I'm talking a lurking danger of an adversary on your backside when you're facing east to.
And while we kept on resisting that, we ended up having exactly that same thing. Before a PAPS was actually agreed on between Kabul and Pakistan,
okay, if I take
Afghanistan
your word,
was
if
you, actually practically working against you.
If I take your word that it went against us while we were working against it, do you think we'll change our policy now? We won't. That's my opinion, that when you're looking eastwards, then you don't want the East having influence in the West as well. So I think Pakistan will agree to inform India of progress in Afghanistan, but it won't see any substantial role for India in that country anytime soon, unless there's a stability in that country and unless there's a progress on the major issues that we face with India.
But right. May I ask, we have legitimate concerns with regard to Afghanistan. My worry is that on one hand, we say that Indian intelligence agencies are using Afghan soil. Then when it comes to, the Afghan peace and stability, then we say, no, Indians have no role. My issue is that if you have legitimate concerns, you can talk to the Indians that look that these are our concerns because we also wanted to discuss India, because India at the moment says that terrorism is a big issue. Pakistan also says that we are also suffering because of Indian-sponsored terrorism.
Yeah.
So when we discuss with India, Afghanistan naturally comes in for discussion. So why we are shying away from this? I believe the best course is that we should have candid discussion with the Indians.
I could rather talk to a wall because India doesn't respond. My Prime Minister actually openly says, let us talk. My Army Chief says, let us talk. Everybody on this Pakistani spectrum.
But again, what option
India doesn't.
Eventually, there will be negotiations.
I would rather talk on Kashmir issue than Afghanistan.
Right.
Let's move on to that particular aspect. As you said, Prime Minister Imran Khan has on a number of occasions offered India a peace process to begin with.
Sir.
But we haven't heard anything from India except that their mantra of terrorism.
And they're regressing. So, and every day the media worsens.
I will maintain Pakistan would be ready to talk to India and Afghanistan if Pakistan sees a role of India and Afghanistan.
Okay.
And if that role is to withdraw their intelligence agencies, yes, Pakistan would be ready to talk to them.
And you can very easily convince Pakistan that it starts seeing a role if you actually start winning hearts and minds in Pakistan. That means first work on Kashmir and work on coming up with a framework between India and Pakistan.
Work on the less serious problem of Sir Creek.
Okay.
Siachen,
no,
Kashmir.
Okay. Of course.
So you have issue.
Kashmir is the heart of
issue,
the problem.
The issue is that it will not serve any useful purpose for Pakistan to waste your energies in blocking India's economic and business project in Afghanistan.
How do you block that?
No, Pakistan trying to block
by not giving them the Afghan transit trade that he's talking about, I believe.
No, I mean, you cannot just carve out a corridor and say that now it becomes India and Afghanistan's property. Otherwise, Pakistan has done a lot. I remember when Afghanistan was invaded,
at that time, I remember Tata's buses moving on.
Do you still believe that Pakistan did a lot of favor to U.S. in Afghanistan war from 2001, but we were poorly compensated.
Yeah.
We were destroyed, but we're not compensated enough. Again, if you want to give something to India, there has to be negotiations on quid pro quo.
And even
if you want to help U.S. on Afghanistan to withdraw, U.S. to withdraw from there, our Prime Minister may be a shy person asking for aid or something, but there has to be quid pro quo, very well-defined quid pro quo or Afghanistan even today.
And at least somebody, especially the three major power partners, that is the U.S., China, and Russia, which agree that there has to be a peace process between India and Pakistan.
Pakistan has to be compensated.
Need to prod India to start actually doing something, otherwise things will be difficult.
And I think that will happen. I think the impression that you are getting that if there will be no negotiations between India and Pakistan, you will see that things in coming months, you will see that there will be some movement. So my contention was that there will be some engagement between Pakistan and India in coming months.
I mean, Kartarpur is one thing. Let us face it, we need a peace process which is enduring. And that doesn't seem to be happening very soon. Let me thank you now, because otherwise my producer is going to come in and say that you have to conclude. Kamran Yusuf, thank you very much for your time. ABM retired Faiz Ameer sir, thank you very much, sir, for your time as well. Umar Farooq sir, thank you very much, sir, for being here as well. Viewers, when you talk about Afghanistan and the U.S. role in Afghanistan, then you have to look at the regional partners, regional countries that have actually played a role or might actually play a role. The biggest problem is, as it happened in SAARC, that it became a hostage of India-Pakistan rivalry. Similar things keep happening in Afghanistan as well. Instead of actually resolving the underlying issues between the two countries, we see that New Delhi keeps on struggling to shape a world based on realpolitik, not collective security. If you want a better future for the region, then that will have to change. If that doesn't, then we are moving nowhere. But Pakistan's commitment is there regarding Afghanistan. Let us hope that Pakistan and the US keep moving forward together and the confidence building further strengthens. This was today's program. Thank you very much for watching us. Take care.